Have you ever known something to be an absolute fact? And I mean, you just knew it was a fact, that this is just the way it was going to be.
Yeah.
And then come to find out you were wrong. I mean, you looked at all the evidence, and you weighed the evidence, and you weighed everything that happened, and you said, this can't possibly go this way. And then you were wrong. In our story this morning, we're going to find out that is part of this guy's life. For those that are visiting with us, I've been preaching a series on Stirred Up. God stirring up stuff in us, or around us, as is the case this morning, where he can stir the atmosphere, he can stir things to cause us to see one thing and find out something entirely different. Last night on TV, there was my all-time favorite movie, or one of them, and it was taken from a true event that happened in 1980, and it was the United States hockey team defeating the Russian team. Remember that? That was an absolute impossibility. That could never have happened. And in his address to the team before the game, Herb Brooks says to the team, if we play them 10 times, they might beat us 9. But not today. Today is your day. You've earned this day. Their time is over. Today is your day. You have made it possible. Today. Today you are the greatest hockey team in the world. Now go out there and take it. Woo! I'd run through a wall hearing that every morning. That jacked me up every morning, you know. And they did. And we will remember forever Al Michaels at 5 seconds left in the game. He's counting down. 8, 7, 6, 5. Do you believe in miracles? And the buzzer goes off. And if you miss that event live, wow. The whole country became alive. That message spoke to the heart of America. It revived us because we were in such despair at that time. Sort of the story of the man this morning. If you have your Bibles, turn to the Gospel of John, the 5th chapter. Gospel of John, the 5th chapter. We're going to begin with verse 1. If you got it, say amen.
Amen.
All right, here we go. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Now there is in Jerusalem, near the sheep gates, a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by 5 covered colonnades. Here a great number of disabled people used to lie. They blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. Now it's really interesting that we're talking about this particular pool and this particular colonnade, because for years and years and years, scientists and history professors taught this was made up. This was Jesus just made this story up. It didn't really exist. There was no such place until 1948, when a guy actually stumbles on it. Archaeologists dig it up, and lo and behold, there's a pool there, and there is 5 colonnades that surround this pool. So I love it. I've said for a long time, every time a scientist opens his mouth, an archaeologist puts his foot in it. Amen?
Amen.
So this guy has been there for 38 years. Let's talk about this place. And they bring his mat, they set him on his mat, and for 38 years, he's been trying to be the first one to get in the pool. Which just from the very fact that he's paralyzed hinders him from going in to the water. So he's working under some adverse circumstances to start with. But for 38 years, this is his only hope. But after 38 years, you've got to be thinking, I ain't getting in there. Wouldn't you? I mean, most of us would quit after the third day. And we do stuff like, well, if God wanted to heal me, he'd just heal me here at home. And that would be our approach to the whole thing. 38 years, he keeps coming back. He keeps coming back. He has an expectation that somehow, some way, somebody's going to help him get into the water. And that's a ton of faith right there. Now, society looked at this man as a loser. And under the Jewish system of thinking, what they said was he obviously had created some big sin for God to punish him by giving him this. Now, I don't know whether God gave him this, so that 38 years later, somebody named Jesus could deal with him. I don't know. But nevertheless, the story goes on. One who was there had been there, an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there, and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, do you want to get well? Don't you? I mean, I wonder if the guy looked at him and said, are you stupid? He didn't know him. I mean, I would have asked that question. No, dude, I'm just, you know, laying around here hoping somebody gives me a ham sandwich. What are you talking about? No, I want to get well. Yeah, I want to get well. Sir, the invalid replied, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me. What they believed, what the tradition had taught for years and years and years and years, as when the water got stirred, it had miraculous powers, and you would go into the water and come out healed. Now, I don't know if that ever happened. It's very likely that this is a live artesian well that stirred. You've seen them bubble up, right? I mean, everybody knows what I'm talking about. So maybe it just did that, and they thought the angels were there, and they went down in. Or maybe somebody had enough faith, they went in the water, they got healed. I don't know. We don't know anything else about the story. But he's like, his reality is, I can't get there because I don't have anyone to help me. When it stirred, and Jesus looks at him. Then Jesus said to him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. Here again, this is me. Hello. Right. Dude, I'm paralyzed. At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. Jesus says to him, get up. Man, do you think he felt the strength come into his legs? And he stands up you imagine the expression on his face when he gets up? Let me say a couple things about Jesus here. Jesus doesn't go, what you need to do is pray more. Jesus doesn't say to him, listen, if you start attending worship more, you might get a miracle. He doesn't say that to him. He doesn't say you need to go to the temple and offer some sacrifice and maybe, you know, something can happen to you. He says to him, get up. And the strength comes into his legs, and this man gets up. He says, pick up your mat and walk. Man, I believe this dude started walking and ended up running.
Amen.
Because the next line says, the day on which this took place was the Sabbath. And so the Jewish leader said to the man who had been healed, it is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat. Well, now, what happened there? 1 minute Jesus done to get up, the next minute he's dealing with the religious leaders, which means he took off walking and took off running and probably ran toward the temple. Because Jesus ain't in the picture. He just outran him.
Yeah.
And they're like, hey, dude, what are you doing carrying that mat? The religious police stopped him. I said, hey, it's the Sabbath. What are you doing carrying that mat? You see, because the Jewish law at this point in time had grown so crazy in its religiosity that it says you can't do anything on the Sabbath. Pray that your outhouse ain't more than 80 feet from your house. Because if it's further than that, you're in trouble. So Jesus is dealing with that mindset. The law forbids you to carry your mat. Here's this guy's quandary. Here he is. Wait a minute. The guy that just healed me told me to pick up my mat. Now what would you do? I'm picking up the mat. I'm picking up Jesus if he wants me to. Here, climb on board. Y'all carry it.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So he picks up his mat, he's going down the road, and the religious police stop him and say, don't you know you can't do that on the Sabbath? But he replied, the man who made me well said to me, pick up your mat and walk. So they ask, who is this fellow who told you to pick up and walk? The man who was healed had no idea who he was, for Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. Who told you to do that? He says, the guy that healed me told me to pick up my mat and walk. I'm doing what he told me. So this set of scriptures is just loaded with stuff. And I just want to share a couple of things as I read this. First of all, 38 years this guy remained faithful to do what he did, hoping that somehow he would get something out of the exercise of what he perceived was his healing. Sometimes, brothers and sisters, we do religious things. And the reason that we do them is because our parents did them. And our parents' parents did them. And our parents' parents' parents did them. I mean, if you're like my wife, Sandy, she's gone to church since she was an infant. She don't know any better. That didn't sound right. I mean, she doesn't know not going to church, to fellowship, right? That's what I meant. She doesn't know what that's like. So she grew up in the Methodist church, the institutional Methodist church, they were crazy. So she learned all the things about the Methodist church, and so a lot of what framed her thinking was framed in the Methodist church. As she got older, she began to question some of the things, and she had to work out certain things in her own faith. Not that there's anything wrong with the Methodist church, just there was some questions she had, and she said, wait a minute, let me look at this. She served on every committee. She's been on every committee. And ran most of them. So she grew up. She was a youth minister in the Methodist church. So her background is in a certain structure and a certain way of doing things. But she got set free by the Holy Spirit. And she knows that just because you do something doesn't make you Christ-like. Being Christ-like makes you Christ-like. And she found out about the Spirit, and she found out about earth things. So she, when people sometimes ask her, what is she? She says, I'm Methodist. Got a little bit of both, a little Pentecostal, a little Methodist. She's a Christian. That's what she'll tell you. She loves Jesus. She follows Jesus. And here's the point. Sometimes we see what we think is a stirring up of something, and we want to go get it. People run after the Spirit. They run after seeking the Spirit. If somebody don't hear a breakout in Lakeland or a breakout in Pensacola, they will run to try to find it. I'm not saying that's a bad thing. I'm just saying he's standing right beside you. This guy is trying to get in the water because he thinks the water, when it's stirred, has something. So he looks at it and he sees it stirred. So there are people who jump from church to from fellowship to fellowship to fellowship looking for something that's standing right beside them. Well, I like this preacher better. I like their choir better. I like my da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Following a stirring when they need to be stirred by the one that's standing beside them.